Hi followers of Neuro Takeaway, welcome back to the channel. Today, speaking from the interior of PowerPoint, so it's a pleasure to be here. I would like to reveal you the diagnosis of the last neuro quiz, which was Erdheim-Chester disease. And here I would like to tell you how the diagnosis was made. The procedure was a biopsy, a stereotaxic biopsy of the cerebellum. And the microscope revealed perivascular infiltration of lymphocytes and a lot of clusters of histiocytes, foamy histiocytes. The first diagnosis was vasculitis, but because everything was negative, the molecular biology for microorganisms and viruses was negative. So they decided to perform a genetic analysis, a sequencing that revealed a mutation in 5.5% of the lectures for BRAF gene, the V600 mutation, which is very well known. Here at my left, you can see the pathway of the MAP kinases. First, you have the receptor of the tyrosine kinase, then the RAS, RAF, MEK, and ERK, and finally, the transcriptional factors in the nucleus. And basically, this pathway has to do with proliferation, survival, mitosis. And there are reported other mutations at the level of the RAS and MEK in histiocytosis, including there are some possible mutations in the fosfatidyl inositol kinase AKT pathway that has to do with mTOR. But one of the most frequent related to Erdheim-Chester disease that occurred in around 80% of cases is the mutation of BRAF, the V600. Well, histiocytosis refers to a group of neoplastic disorders that has to do with proliferation of cells of the mononuclear phagocyte system, which are the monocytes, the macrophages, and the dendritic cells. This group of cells can transform into each other depending on the context, on the activation, and some of them have pro-inflammatory profile, some an anti-inflammatory profile, depending on the context. Most of them derived from the bone marrow, from a stem cell, but some of them derived from the yolk sac. For example, the microglia of the brain that represents around 15% of the cells of the glia in the central nervous system. And when activated, they can be very, very similar. You can differentiate an activating microglia from a macrophage. So the picture is complex and is all the time changing because of new discoveries. Well, and here you have the latest classification of histiocytosis from the Histiocyte Society from 2016. They divided these processes in five categories or groups. Group A, which comprises Langerhans cell histiocytosis, indeterminate cell histiocytosis, Erdheim-Chester disease, and a mixed group of Erdheim-Chester and Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Around 20% of patients with Erdheim-Chester also have Langerhans cells. The differentiation of these cells has to do with the expression of certain surface markers. For example, Langerhans cells express CD1A and CD207 or Langerin. Erdheim-Chester cells express CD68 and CD163. And the most important thing maybe that in this group, there is a lot of mutations of the MAP kinase pathways, as we said before, in around 80% of cases. Then you have group C that has to do with the cutaneous histiocytosis. And an example of this is juvenile central granuloma. Then group R, or Rosaif-Dorfman disease, which is very important for us as neurologists, because it can be located in the brain or in the orbit. Then you have group M, or malignant histiocytosis. And finally, group H, hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, that has to do with the macrophagic activation syndrome. Erdheim-Chester disease has many phases. There is a typical or classical form, which is associated with bone compromised, especially in the limbs. But there are other variants. For example, there is one without bone compromised, and maybe our patient suffered from this type. Then there is another variant associated with myeloproliferative or myelodysplastic processes, such as Hodgkin lymphoma or leukemias. And finally, the juvenile central granuloma in the extracutaneous or disseminated form of this process, associated with MAP kinases activating mutations or ALK translocations. Erdheim-Chester disease is a process that occurs more frequently in males around the age of 40, 60, or 60 years old, depending on the series that you have. But the most important thing is we have to get a biopsy to have the histopathological findings in the context of the proper clinical and radiological findings. Here you have the typical histopathology. On H&E, you can see the histiocytes full of lipids, the typical foamy histiocytes. And here on the immunohistochemistry, you can see that they bind to CD68, which is the typical marker of these cells, and they don't bind to the markers of Langerhans cells. The more frequent symptom is pain, especially in the lower limbs, and it is associated with the compromise of the bones at the level of the diaphysis and metaphysis of the long bones of the lower limbs, especially the distal parts of the femuris and the proximal and distal parts of the tibias and fibulas. Regarding the radiological findings, this is associated with osteosclerosis of these bones, and occasionally we can see some changes on MR. But the most sensitive study is FDG PET, where you can see the increase of the uptake of this marker at this level in a symmetrical way. The compromise of these bones and these symptoms is present in around 95% of cases. So it is very, very frequent. But as we said, there is a form without this symptom, as we saw in our patient. Other organs and other symptoms that can be associated with Erdheim-Chester are, for example, the cardiovascular compromised. It happens in around 50% of cases. It is usually asymptomatic and can be detected on CT and on MR as a thickening of the walls of the aorta and of the heart. Then we can have alterations of the skin. You can see the main symptom here, central asthma at the level of the eyelids. We can have alterations of the lungs that can be seen as a micronodular ground glass appearance with thickening of the septa. We can see compromise of the retroperitoneal space with fibrosis at this level and the typical hairy kidney appearance. And finally, we can have CNS compromised. It happens in around from 20 to 30% of cases, and it can have three flavors. One is the compromise of the orbits with exophthalmos because of infiltration with this tissue of the retrobulbar spaces. Then we can have dural thickening, as in Rosai-Dorfman disease. And finally, the intraaxial compromised, as in our patient, with compromise of the posterior fossa. We don't know why, but this area of the brain, of the encephalus, is the most frequently compromised, the brainstem and the cerebellum. And it can be associated with contrast enhancement, as in our case, or it can be associated with a neurodegenerative pattern, as happens in Langerhans cell histiocytosis. When it comes to treatment, there is no standardized treatment here, but the most frequent drugs are pegylated alpha interferon, cladribine, and some interleukin inhibitors as tocilizumab or anakinra. Sometimes when there is a lesion associated with mass effect, you can turn to surgery, steroids, or radiotherapy. And the new drugs are those that inhibit the affected pathway, in this case, the MAPK pathway. For example, BRAF inhibitors of bemurafenib, or MEK inhibitors, or a combination of these drugs. So with this, I finish with this rare, but I think very interesting case. See you in 2 weeks. Bye-bye.